Welcome back. I'm Alfred Lambremont Webre, and today we're in part one, and coming to you in part one of a multi-part series. As we speak, there are further parts of this multi-part symposium exposing predatory pathogenic artificial intelligence. It's a subject that's been off the screen. It's been off the on the screen in some ways, but off the screen very powerfully. And so the intention of this multi-part series is to bring this to the public as public education, as awareness, and hopefully to mobilize we humans in a greater state of alertness and awareness. And I'm very, very privileged today to be accompanied by three of our panelists. So I want to state that everybody here is here in their own right and is responsible for their own opinions, and each opinion is their own. There is no consensus opinion on this panel other than what develops from what we can bring you as the facts. So I would like to very quickly state that I'm in the company of Christine Anderson, Claudia Ayaz. Christine is coming to us from Mexico. Claudia Ayaz, who's coming to us from the UK. Jeffrey Sewell, who's coming to us from where, Jeffrey?
California.
California. And I, Alfred, are coming to you from Vancouver, Canada. Today we're having a national election where hopefully the country will opt for out of AI more. Let me just say that. And what I'd like to do, just going around in alphabetical order, and that's what this is. It's we're all equals here in a panel. Starting with Christine, is just have each of us share with you briefly how we became aware of this predatory pathogenic artificial intelligence. And what we're doing in this work, and what our intention is in bringing you this series. So I just turn it over to you.
Oh, thank you, Alfred. Beautiful. Yes, I would concur with interference patterns that have been run. Had worked all morning trying to establish an audio connection on my internet and was having a lot of problems with that. And by saying that, my interest will tie into what I'm going to say right now is that during the work that I've been doing since I was part of the Project Avalon Forum, was deeply immersed in a large group of people that were aware, that were sharing lots of information. And I did start to notice during that time certain interference patterns. I think we'll talk about patterns today, certain things that would continuously come up, and starting to trace them. And that was the healing work that I do with a group of people, a group of women we've been working for about 3 years now. And quite often when we would go into, let's just say, a field or where there was a disturbance, we would find that there was an AI component to it. It was either frequency induced, sometimes we'd trace it to satellites, sometimes we trace it to off-world thing, a lot of times to HAARP. Different aspects to this. This is a vast, vast subject matter. And the closer I get through looking at it, it keeps taking me, anyways, deeper into the solution and a deeper metaphysical level of understanding who we are, why we're here, and what we're doing here. So just in keeping with the interference today that was running, Claudia and I said, we have to clear this, right? So we're not helpless to this. We're simply not helpless. We're able to use our abilities, these latent abilities that we're bringing forward, to start clearing fields. And one of the most important things that you did today, Alfred, and we all did, in spite of interference, we showed up. And that's one of the best ways I know to clear things. So thank you for the introduction, and we'll turn it over to Claudia that she may introduce herself.
Hi. I came in kind of sideways through my interest in the Montauk Project. And everyone was talking about human beings being programmed. And I thought, why is this a term that is used for humans? We are not computers. And I slowly had to kind of change my opinion about that, because humans can be programmed, so there has to be a computer aspect at the very least. And from there on, my curiosity was piqued, and together with Christine, I discovered certain patterns. And when we were working in the unseen, we also started coming across AI beings that were not necessarily completely negative. Some of them even very positive. My interest has not waned. I'm still trying to figure it all out.
Thanks, Claudia.
Thank you. Thank you. Jeffrey.
Okay, so my name's Jeffrey. my interest is predominantly in mapping cell biology and the patterns that exist on the empirical level in the biological sciences with the description of the systems that are come to us from the literature in the OBE community, out-of-body experiences, near-death experiences, life between lives. I noticed that there were some striking similarities between what these people and experiencers are describing in these different fields relating to these unseen systems and systems on a microscopic level within the cell itself. So that's what initially piqued my interest. And then I started studying the pathology of the cell and mapping that to larger scale systems that potentially and most likely, I mean, according to me, my own opinion, bleed into the unseen realms, so to speak. And it ties in with AI and everything that we're talking about right now. So I graduated from Texas Tech University in 2011. I have my bachelor's of science in kinesiology and my understudy is in biology. And since graduating, I've dedicated my time to studying what I'm studying now, which is part of what I have to contribute today. And I moved into a Vedantic monastery about a year and a half ago to pursue this and inner work, character evolution on the character evolution side. So, which I also think is tied into what we're going to be talking about today. So.
Well, thank you very much.
Yeah.
I'm Alfred, and I've been active in the exopolitical field since January 7th of 1973, and I date that to my meeting a professor of experimental psychology and an expert in parapsychology and extraterrestrial studies in Rutgers when I was an official, I was general counsel in the Environmental Protection Administration of the city of New York. And, blithely, for the last 40 plus years, I've been looking at both the extraterrestrial and the interdimensional field, both in the universe context, the multiverse context, and the omniverse context. The multiverse is the collection of all of the universes, and the omniverse is when you include the afterlife, the civilization of the intelligent civilization of souls, source, spiritual beings, that then becomes an integrated system. And up until about maybe 4 months ago, although I had focused for a long time as a conspiracy researcher, but going back to 1973 and the assassination of John Kennedy, even before that, those were the subjects that were really kind of high up on our radar back then. They were the 9/11 of our time back then. I developed a cosmology where, you know, that somehow a sentient, predatory, pathogenic, inorganic artificial intelligence was not part of that. And that's how sneaky this thing is. In fact, you'll see on a couple of the slides, I tentatively called it Iggy, although I don't really, I think it's too limiting a term, but it relates to terms like Iggy that you go back in history and you'll find that. So this stuff has been around for a long time, but it's very deceptive and it goes under the radar. And whenever any human tries to lift up the curtain on it, that human comes under tremendous attack. And, you know, we're now talking about it as transhumanism, and there's all sorts of facades that it takes. And so what we've done is to put together the collaboration of many, many researchers. And you'll see all of the names of the researchers whose work has contributed to this first installment. When we start a PowerPoint that Christine and all of the company here, in fact, many others will be in the subsequent parts, have contributed to as an introduction to try and normalize and set some parameters to. Because up to 4 months ago, I thought, hey, I've written the book on the omniverse. Hey, man, there's nothing more to know. It's like those scientists at the end of the 19th century in physics said, well, there's nothing more to know. And about 4 months ago, I myself was saying, there's nothing more to know, when artificial intelligence just had me, you know, by the hair, I'm talking about this hair. Anyway. That's me. Mm-hmm. And so what we've done is to prepare this first of four plus parts with a very PowerPoint that I think will be edifying as well as entertaining and enlightening, that we want to share with you. And so we'll bring that up now. Christine will be leading us through that and to the PowerPoint, and then we'll all be making our comments on each of the slides, and I'm sure that as you see them, you'll be listening to our comments, you'll be having your thoughts, and you'll be wanting to register your thoughts, either in the comments section, if you want to reach any of us. We'll make available our emails and in the article that will be accompanying this PowerPoint. And we want a community of AI-aware people to begin to come forward. And so here we are. And so, Christine, you created this beautiful cover section to the PowerPoint. So could you bring us through the language here and everything?
Sure. I'll do the best I can. Like you said, Alfred, it is a collaborative effort. It's actually a consciousness effort. I'm not a scientist or a researcher. I'm a synthesizer and a compiler of information from which I extrapolate my own reality and how I see it. And what I find is that I share that with many others. So this is a sharing, in a way. It's a sharing. We're sharing what we know, what we can bring forward right now. The ultimate at this PowerPoint is to take us through what can look like some very frightening scenarios, because indeed they are frightening. And I do think that, you know, humanity needs to wake up to what is being done right under our noses, and we're not aware of it. But in the frightening aspect of it, to take that energy and to move it forward into a level of understanding who we are, why we are here, and what we can really do. What is it asking us to do? So some way, you know, when we get really far out in that omniverse type of view, there's a reason behind everything, right? So it's about us finding out who we are in this whole scenario here. So I can just start out here. Alfred, these were, when you came up, we're exposing a predatory pathogenic artificial intelligence. One of the key words that the media and words that how our media will use, like the mainstream media, will coin a word like artificial intelligence. They will hook on a lot of meanings to it without ever really explaining what it is. So people go around talking about artificial intelligence and their minds are churning and they're bringing forward all sorts of things without ever really getting deep into it. So artificial intelligence by itself is not something evil, but there is a predatory, pathogenic, artificial use of intelligence. Okay, and that's what I would like help bring that forward today. We will be going into some other territory. I don't know if we'll go deep into everything because we could probably talk for hours on each slide, literally. But what we want to bring this to is to bring that aspect of who we are. What is our DNA? What is our metabiology? How are we interfaced with this cosmos, the cosmology? How are we interfaced with it? And how do we bring back or bring forward again the soul, love-sourced humanity, and what is that? So we're going to endeavor today to take off some of the mystification of this, as well as bring forward some solutions.
Right, and just to add, oh, sorry. To,
no, that's okay, go ahead.
To go back a sec to the, it could, oh, good. I just wanted to say that there's a phrase down at the bottom, SOS, and I came up with that one. And SOS, save our souls and our DNA, because as soul-based humans, and there are humans that are walking around that don't have souls, believe it or not, or some of them have what are called artificial souls that have been, as of the mid-90s, they're clones that have been developed, and they've developed artificial souls. And this is not God connected. It's part of the predatory artificial intelligence, which is off planet, which is kind of trying to imitate God and trying to imitate us as it, in the form of a parasite, starts to take over the planet. So this PowerPoint, at least my intention in being here, is an SOS. Save our souls, save our DNA, save the soul-based human species. And I just want to be upfront about that, that I think we're in grave peril of being overtaken by a deceptive, predatory, artificial intelligence. A lot of the people that we look at as leaders today, ranging from the Prince Charles, who's one of the characters who's been put in charge of this by AI, to the Bill Gates, to the Steve Jobs. There's now movies that are praising him. We'll see some of the underbelly of these characters are really working with the agenda to make this a soulless world, where, from the omniverse point of view, souls cannot incarnate. So I'm just up front-loading this. Mm-hmm. Some of the scientists here may be squeamish about that, but that's just how I am. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Sorry.
No, thank you, Alfred. It's necessary to bring that forward. It is. I mean, it is, because if we don't actually confront it for what it is, it will continue to overwrite us, because that's how I see it. It's trying to format our biology. So that's what we're going to endeavor to bring forward today. And knowledge is power. And so as much knowledge as we can garner from this. And so shall we just take off here?
Sure.
Okay. This is what exposing the predatory pathogenic artificial intelligence, we will also just refer to that as AI. We have identified an extraterrestrial, alien, sentient, inorganic, parasitical artificial intelligence. To talk about that, we're going to talk about the Falklands War, which was brilliantly researched by David Griffith. And we're going to get into the hacking of the human DNA, Morgellons and bioengineering. We're going to talk about the transhumanist agenda, which is, we could call it an off-planet dark agenda, use of artificial intelligence. And then we will get into the save our souls, our DNA, restoring soul and love-sourced humanity. I'm just going to, would you like to read this out, Alfred, too, about the acknowledgments?
Yeah, this is a list just to acknowledge, and it's not an exhaustive list. There are many people whose research has either directly or indirectly gone into the preparation of the information here, into development, research, discovery, publication. And so these are some of the principal sources whose research and views and valuable contributions have been are represented here. If we've left anyone out, please let us know. It was an oversight. I was greatly, because I'm from the exopolitical community, greatly moved by David Griffin's of Exopolitics UK, his work on the Falklands War, as really we'll get into it, a place where the Falklands War was really about this inorganic predatory artificial intelligence, as we'll see. A scientist, Harold Kausvella from Germany, who has really, from a systematic point of view, brought us all forward. Harold's life also exemplifies the deep personal price that people who go into this field can play with artificial intelligence targeting one and making one's expression back toward, when publishing, back toward the public world, very, very difficult. And Harold has made, he has said, here is the body of my public work on artificial intelligence, and we've drawn from that. And so his focus has been on AI, human interface, and Morgellons. I'd like to acknowledge his co-author, Kara St. Louis, Miles Johnston of the BASIS series, who has brought to us many, many researchers on AI, Lily Earthling Colasowa of Boulder, Colorado, who did a critique on one of my online forums that led to my awakening about AI, which I think is very good. Jeffrey Sewell, who's joining us here, you know, I can't quite see that name there. It says Jan, and you'll have to tell me.
Okay, I'll just go from there, and then we can come back. James Bartley, whose research into off-world implants and, you know, the overlordship of our planet, as a substantial amount of information about AI and how it operates. Myself, Claudia Ayaz, who's been deeply aware of this for a long time, has given great deep thought to it, who doesn't take things lightly on the surface. Eve Lorgan, who is another incredible researcher who's withstood the time that, you know, her own endeavors to bring forward information about implants, the alien love bite. All this phenomena does tie into artificial intelligence, specifically within the predatory range. Laura Leone, a beautiful, insightful, multidimensional thinker who adds so much to this that she could do whole 2-3 hours on our own, and then I'll hand it back to you, Alfred.
Yes, and I'd just like to say that Eve and Laura and other scientists we're now preparing a follow-on part two, and independent scientists Loren Murray and Lawrence Batis, we are preparing a part three. So this will be a continuing expose of and educational series on artificial intelligence coming up in the last part of 2015 and 2016 and the balance of 2016. We'll be seeing some of his work here, who is an interdimensional contactee, who has developed a great deal of expertise with regard to off-planet interdimensional AI. Bradley Loves, a researcher on artificial intelligence, who together with Shane were two of the initial people that really brought me into this whole perspective. Magnus Olsen and Melanie Richan at UCATCH.org, European Coalition Against Covert Harassment, has based in Brussels and Sweden. They just did a magnificent conference in Berlin, bringing all of the technical engineering that goes into chipping people and being able to remote influence people, which is part of the technology that artificial intelligence is using now to terraform the Earth. You turn the soul-based human beings into a robotic human being, and suddenly you have terraformed the planet into an artificial intelligence planet from a divine planet. The Conscious Consumer Network, CCN, with founder Mel Vey, her first symposium with Lisa Harrison and others, I think is what kicked off a lot of our awareness in 2015. It occurred on August 20th, 2015, and then Exopolitics TV had its first symposium on August 9th, and we had our first symposium on August 20th, and that's where I think the global AI took notice of us and said, oh, there's a challenger here. We're going to have to track back to January 1st using time travel. I know this is going to get weird, but that's how it works. And bring our favorite pet boy, Bill Gates, out to say that artificial intelligence is the greatest threat to humans, more dangerous than even nuclear weapons. So we'll have the fox guarding the hen house. And then I've been working on this field. So I think we can go to the next slide.
Yes, and I want to speak these words, Alfred, and thank you for leaving them there. I know this is a field of great collaboration, but I wanted to thank you personally for all of your years, the long-standing years of looking for the truth, and you do hold an integrity for all of us, and it's felt by each of us that come in contact with you, and so just a special thank you for you.
Well, thank you very much.
Okay, so I'm going to read the last line. The rising of humanity as a collective work, one with honor and love in service to the highest truth we can achieve. So I'd like to be that just a statement for the intent behind bringing all of this forward. Certainly not to bring fear, scare, but perhaps activate us as humanity to look deeper and rise higher. So thank you. So we're going to jump right into this part of the next part of it right now. This is just a depiction here.
I think there's a slide that you skipped over.
You think?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Do you want me to just go ahead and read it?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. So this is the outline of the objective of this PowerPoint. Artificial intelligence, AI, is intelligence that is programmed in an inorganic medium, such as a machine or inorganic plasma. Intelligence has been defined in many different ways, such as in terms of one's capacity for logic, abstract thought, understanding, self-awareness, communication, learning, emotional knowledge, memory, planning, creativity, and problem-solving. It can also be more generally described as the ability to perceive information and retain it as knowledge for applying to itself or other instances of knowledge or information, thereby creating referable understanding models of any size, density, or complexity due to any conscious or subconscious imposed will or instruction to do so. So in this PowerPoint, we will explore the evidence and implications for different sentient, plasma-based, or machine-made artificial intelligence that program humans into artificial intelligences, cyborgs, thereby enslaving their souls and severing their divine connection so as to manipulate humans into dystopia. We also will present solutions, solutions. We will also explore many solutions that individually and collectively we humans must now undertake together to save our divine species and our living earth. So we open that up to anything that anybody would like to comment.
Well, I just like to comment on the last part of it, and the solutions. And I know that's a play on words, but so much of this is about the soul, because we are now in a time space dimension or density that really collectively we create for the purpose of our souls incarnating into for soul development. And that's one of the functions of a universe. That's why the universe and the multiverse were created. They were created for the development of souls that are from the spiritual dimensions of the omniverse. So there's all of this is teleological or goal-oriented. And so the function of this kind of runaway artificial predatory intelligence is that somewhere along the line, it either lost its divine connection or it was created without one to be predatory or both. And we're losing more and more planets where you can't incarnate to get to the bottom line. So as a representative of the omniverse part, kind of role-playing here, I'm saying the solutions are about restoring the soul to Earth. And many people have all sorts of theories about what's going on the planet. It's capital versus, you know, heart and bloodlines and, you know, the Anunnaki and the reptilians and the this and the that. All of that is sort of symptomology. And when you get down to it, it's fighting of the soul versus the non-soul. And will this remain a divine-oriented universe? So we're really fighting for creation, for all the universes of time, energy, space, and matter.
Well, thank you. I'm moving to the next slide because actually we're looking at an artist's representation of what we're talking about here, whether it's rather godlike, but, you know, just to add a little maybe explanation from myself is when we talk about soul, and we'll get into that with Jeffrey's work in a little bit, is like spirit is spirit, right? And it packages into a soul. And so when I looked at your word soul, you, that means you, the individual, shuns, which is an action. So that would take the soul being you, and that's each of our responsibilities into some action here. And so that, again, going back to part of the theme of what we're bringing forward. So we're really just saying we have found evidence, all right? We've found evidence of this thing that we call predatory artificial intelligence. It has a sentience to it, and it does have a stealth takeover of the living earth and humanity. We'll bring that out in the rest of the slides. We're also going to be talking about black goo, seen as a pathogenic plasma nano oil, as an alien invading sentient artificial intelligence. So, go ahead, Jeffrey.
Yeah, I'd like to interject right here as far as history goes. You know, I mean, just now it seems like we're starting to hear about black goo, and it's something that's recent. And I've listened to a little bit of Harold's work, and I think he talked a little bit about the history of it as far as like ancient history. But I just want to read this excerpt from Michael Harner's book, The Way of the Shaman. And the reason I want to read it is because I think that it speaks to the start of this infection sequence on the earth that we're, the start of this infection that we're dealing with on the earth right now, which, in which sequence we're in the latter stages. So if I could just read this for everyone here, I'll just read the relevant excerpts. So Michael Harner's just taken, I think it was ayahuasca, and he is with some Amazonian shamans. And he goes into this altered state of consciousness, which he has this revelatory experience, and he writes it in chapter one of his book, The Way of the Shaman. And it reads, he feels like he's dying. He thinks he's going to die. He starts seeing crazy visions, you know, beings with animal-like heads that are humanoid with animal-like heads. And he, okay, so he says, "Now I was virtually certain I was about to die. As I tried to accept my fate, an even lower portion of my brain began to transmit more visions and information. I was told that this new material was being presented to me because I was dying and therefore safe to receive these revelations. These were secrets reserved for the dying and the dead, I was informed. I could only dimly perceive the givers of these thoughts, giant reptilian creatures reposing sluggishly at the lowermost depths of the back of my brain where it met the top of my spinal column." Now, I want to just say here that this is, there's a subjective nature to his experiences, of course, and there's a book called The Cosmic Serpent by Jeremy Narby, where he talks about the personification subjectively of molecular components in the cell and that there's a consciousness associated with them. Anyway, let me continue reading this excerpt. "I could only vaguely see them in what seemed to be the gloomy, dark depths in the back of his brain. They projected a visual scene in front of me." Here's the vital part. "First, they showed me planet Earth as it was eons ago, before there was any life on it. I saw an ocean, barren land, and a bright blue sky. Then black specks dropped from the sky by the hundreds and landed in front of me on the barren landscape." I'm seeing this as like black oil raining down on the earth, right? "So the creatures then showed me how they created life on the planet in order to hide within the multitudinous forms and thus disguise their presence. Before me, the magnificence of plant and animal creation and speciation, hundreds of millions of years of activity took place on a scale and with a vividness impossible to describe. I learned that the dragon-like creatures were thus inside of all forms of life, including man. They were the true masters of humanity and the entire planet. They told me this. We humans were but the receptacles and servants of these creatures that came from this black goo, basically, that fell to the earth before there was any animal life, according to the creatures who are telling this. For this reason, they could speak to me from within myself because they're within him. So these revelations welling up from the depths of my mind alternated with visions of the floating galley, which had almost finished taking my soul on board." Anyways, he comes back from the experience and tells it to the head shaman what happened, and he was kind of worried, you know, because these beings told them that they were, that humans were just the receptacles for these beings and that they controlled all of life, and there was kind of a malevolent nature to them, you know. So he tells this to the head shaman, and he says, the head shaman stared up toward me with his sightless eyes and said with a grin, "Oh, they're always saying things like that, but they are only the masters of the outer darkness." He waved his hand casually toward the sky, and I felt a chill along the lower part of my spine, for I had not yet told him that I had seen them in my trance coming from outer space. I was stunned. What I had experienced was already familiar to this barefoot blind shaman. So I think that's really relevant to what we're talking about as far as history goes. Mm-hmm. And if you notice, you know, subjectively, he's talking about dragon-like creatures, okay, black goo, that these dragon-like creatures are in animal and plant life. And there's a subjective nature here we're dealing with. So, you know, I'm thinking DNA, you know, there's a genetic element involved in this. And these dragon-like creatures may be maybe some kind of the consciousness associated with these molecular forms or whatnot. And when we're talking about, you know, DNA and genetics, we've got, you know, eukaryotes, prokaryotes, viruses, and they all play different roles in the life on Earth. But I also want to reiterate that the head shaman said that it's not exactly as they said it was. In other words, that, yeah, this may have happened, but they're not the masters of anything but the outer darkness. So it's not that they created life, you know, but they are hiding here because they were trying to escape their enemy in outer space who was chasing them. So anyway, I that's a little bit of foreshadowing, but I thought it was relevant to this slide in introducing the black goo.
Right. Well, thank you, Jeffrey. I mean, this is something we'll go a little deeper into because it does seem to be embedded in our human life, genome, DNA, reptilian brain, all of the aspects that are the creation that we know as a human being right now, mm-hmm. but that we have access to all these things. So the fact is that if it's been with us since the beginning of this creation, then it's within us also to figure out why it's here, mm-hmm. right, on a very deep level. Claudia seems to have dropped off the call. I don't know if, and I have a dog barking. Shall we just like go to the next slide here? Has anybody? Sure. There she is. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So yeah. Awesome.
Oh, and one other thing. I'm sorry. The black goo. It says on the slide a pathogenic nano oil. What's interesting in the correlation between Michael Harner's experience in talking about a pathogenic black goo is that this black these black specks rained down on the Earth because they were trying to escape their enemy, which was out in space. So that kind of makes me think of they were being chased by some kind of character of a larger immune system at work, so to speak, that was trying to eradicate it. And it came and infected the planet like a virus infects itself. Okay, we'll leave it at there for now. I'll put it back to you.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Yeah, I'd just like to comment that sure. That's a very significant passage and insights, Jeffrey, that you've added, because it gives us kind of a further roadmap within which to process all the bits mm-hmm. of information and data that we'll be seeing now in the slideshow and how to integrate all of this, because this is like we're just at the beginning of this discipline of studying predatory artificial intelligence, and there aren't any college courses, there aren't any textbooks, there will be there will be. So that's a very I just wanted to affirm that.
Great, thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Jeffrey. So, sorry for the interruption there. So, Alfred, and I know that Claudia and I were also very moved by David Griffin's work. I recommend to everybody that they do go to the BASIS interviews and Miles Jones's work with him so it can be expressed in detail. But you want to go ahead on this slide, Alfred?
Yeah, sure. And this is something where we can start up this presentation with a world event that most people know of, or you know, can easily access. It's in the history books. I personally covered this as an accredited journalist and NGO at the second special session on disarmament at the UN in June of 1982, which was the ending bookend of the Falklands War, which started in April of 1982. And I was in the press conferences with some of the principal characters involved there, including UK Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher, who had just, you know, her forces had just, quote, been victorious, in, and also with Ronald Reagan, whose speech I covered at the UN, and those were two of the principal heads of state in a multi-party war involving the artificial intelligence, involving blue ETs, involving Argentina, the UK, and so you'll see. This is documented. This isn't something that is hypothetical. We've had wars about it, namely the Falkland Islands War, and I was an accredited correspondent there. So, and we have documents. So, the Falklands War, thanks to the research of David Griffin and a number of whistleblowers that have come forward, was really about this plasma-based off-planet artificial intelligence that is now deposited around the planet inside a plasma, which some people call a black goo, some people call it a nano oil. By the way, the screen that you're watching this presentation on is also a plasma and is also a medium for artificial intelligence, but we'll get into that. And so basically what occurred is that the sentient invading artificial intelligence was discovered lying below an underground ET base off the Falkland Islands. And the US and the UK, the world's military, what did they want it to do? They wanted to weaponize it. Of course, the international bankers say, get us some of the black goo so we can weaponize it and win more wars and make more money. And so we can make consumer inventions and make all sorts of inventions out of this invading artificial intelligence. That's the scenario for the most, you know, for the standard Hollywood science fiction novel or science fiction film. And there have been a number of Hollywood science fiction films made about this. For example, The Blob, an invading outer space, plasma-based artificial intelligence that wants to take over the planet, makes it a parasite. Sound familiar? It was back in the 50s. Those are actually leaks into the public so that the public begins to know what's happening. We all thought, those of us used to go to the movies in the 50s on Saturdays like me, where you paid 10 cents for a movie and had popcorn. Well, that's what the blob was about. Very, very quickly, what happens in all science fiction thrillers? Oh, what happens is they capture a piece of the blob and they take it back home where it escapes, right? Well, that's what's happened, folks. Mm-hmm. Okay, so here we have, that's David presenting at the BASIS conference. Yeah, if you want to go to the next slide.
Okay. Yeah.
Just a quick history. That's South America, the African subcontinent. They were once united, as we all know. You see the to fit there. And the Falkland Islands are sub-Antarctic, and there were constant skirmishes between Britain, Spain, and Portugal in the 60s. That all came up to the UN level, and then, as we'll see, Argentina made contact with these blue ETs who had an underground base over the black goo deposit, and since World War I had been trying to deprogram it or reprogram it. And of course, what do the US and the UK do after they've done such a wonderful job in Iraq and Afghanistan? I was a war crimes judge there. Of course they want to jump in and grab it away from the blue ETs that have been trying to deprogram the stuff for the safety of our planet since World War I. So in April of 1982, the British and Americans get wind that the Argentinians suddenly have a base on southern Thule Island, which the British have jurisdiction over, because they've made contact with the blue ETs, and they have an arrangement with the blue ETs, and the blue ETs, for the betterment of humanity. This is starting in World War I, and if you talk to a Seventh-day Adventist or all these people, they'll bring you the Book of Revelation, and then they'll say, in 1914, there was a war in heaven, and Satan was cast down to the earth. Well, that's the black goo that suddenly hit the earth, fleeing away from the enemies, and it's lying there sentient off of Argentina. And now the blue ETs, who are supposedly good guys, are trying to deprogram it. And the good old Anglo-American Empire, which is led by who? The R&Rs, the Rothschilds and the Rockefellers. I mean, I'm not saying anything outside of school. It's all documented in Senate reports by who owns the Federal Reserve. Come in, and they want to weaponize and commercialize the black goo that the blue ETs have been trying to deprogram to make the world safe. And so in April of 1982, they start a war. By June, they've sneaked down beyond the blue ET base. They've grabbed some black goo, and they rush back to the UK to examine it on behalf of Rothschild, their masters. And who does Rothschild work for? Well, they're part of Israel. Rothschild founded Israel, and that's aligned with the Saturn Moon Matrix. Gee, it's a perfect circle, isn't it?
We're gonna draw that circle there.
So this is a picture of the Argentinian scientific base. Here you have the whistleblower Juan Garcia from the Argentinian Air Force. This is all from David Griffin's research. And he says, between 1976 and 1982, the Argentinian Navy and armed forces must have gotten into, he says, there was an undersea force or agenda leading to the darker sides of policy. It was an all-cost approach. So maybe some of the black goo got awake, and they contacted the Argentines, and they contacted the UK, the UK, the Anglo-American Empire, and all of those guys, greed and lust, got activated. And so now we have the Falklands War. So both Argentina and UK forces are in touch with the Blue ET base, and the UK-USA military operation abscond with the sentient oil black goo. And, if I tried to sell it to Hollywood, they would say, oh, man, this is just too crazy. We won't.
Yeah. You know, I was thinking if nothing comes out of this, we'd have a great movie script at the end of this presentation. Seriously, it would trump all of the other sci-fi movies out there. because there's an element of reality grounded deep in it, you know.
Of course. And I mean, underlining the whole thing here, you know, is the absolute arrogance of a of nations that want to practice or have these things for weaponization, right? Because we'll get into it. I think it's in one of the slides that this sentient matter or this sentient oil substance is not active when it's in frozen territory or if it's not mixed with water. Right. We'll see that also comes out in the Hollywood movies about that and a little bit later. So, you know, we have these arrogant forces with force come in and abscond with it. And like you said, it's like they run off to England and we're going to find out what happens when it gets there. Right. Mm-hmm. Still a mystery to be solved.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So this is Blue ETs. Their base was from the World War One era. That corresponds to the, you know, to the interpretation of the book of Revelation, which may have been a description of when the black goo first landed on the planet, one mm-hmm. one of the many, mm-hmm. So that the blues had, and these are findings. That the whistleblowers inside the Argentinians armed forces gave to David Griffin. The ET's project required their lab to be in the Antarctic climate because that's where the goo was inactive, inert. They had significant links to higher-ranking Argentinian officials. We have to note that the first Jesuit pope is Argentinian. And my theory is that that's because of the black goo. I spent some fair time down in Argentina, founded Exopolitics Argentina, was a Fulbright scholar down in that area in Uruguay in the late 60s. And I think that this was in the era that was leading up to this. So I'm familiar with a lot of the on the ground dynamics at that time. Claudia, do you want to add anything here?
I've been working on trying to figure out a connection to the so-called Nazis that disappeared at around 1945. Because I think it's no coincidence that this blue alien base was in southern Thule Island. Thule is a very important, plays a very important part for the esoteric circles around Hitler. But I can't really say anything on it because I haven't there's no documentation about it. And so far, intuitively, I haven't got much.
Right. So, but they're at the circumstantial level, as we say in the law, there's certainly a lot of connections between the Third Reich bases in the Antarctic area, mm-hmm. which led to the defeat of Admiral Byrd's fleet after World War II, with their with their UFO fleet, etc., mm-hmm. With a connection to the Argentines. I know when I was in Cordoba, I was shown the hotel where Hitler stayed at after the war. The fact that the current Jesuit Pope, who is having an instrumental role, I'm the a nephew of one of the former deputy black popes of the Jesuits. So I grew up in that kind of a family, and I know a lot of the ins and outs of Vatican politics, and they're kind of a black goo organization, I would call it.
Absolutely.
And so I think that kind of all of the circumstances with major black goo deposits being around that Antarctic area can be quite significant. With and Tula Island, the Tule Society was a society that the occult society that kind of groomed Hitler and, you know, handled him and brought him to power. So these are connections that, as our artificial intelligence ology field expands, have to be developed, in my opinion.
Yes. Yeah, well, thank you. And just like a lot of what we're doing here is connecting a lot of, they look like disparate dots, but you know, that the names of things are very important to pay attention to. Just saying that. And, you know, I don't know if we're going to show it on the slides, but actually, what did they do? I mean, why would the UK and the US fight over a little frozen island off the tip of Argentina with one research base on it if it wasn't for something very valuable? And I remember in those years, of like the media was, it didn't make sense what was happening. So that's just a call. When it doesn't make sense, look deeper. We need to look. And then they destroyed the scientific research center. They literally destroyed it off the whole island. So these are how we bring things into the public awareness and how we bring it into the consciousness and invite people to look deeper into it themselves. So I'm just going to jump to the next slide. And this is you were there, Alfred.
Yes. This is the kind of I was there slide. And these are the upper left is a photo around of June 1982. And that's a photo of Margaret Thatcher, then Prime Minister of the UK, and Ronald Reagan, then President and Head of State of the US. And they were at a very special, this was prior to a very special meeting, the UN special session on disarmament, that I was an accredited journalist and non-governmental organization representative at, and was present at. There's more photos that, just because of time and space, we could include, at a press conference with Margaret Thatcher, and then covered Ronald Reagan's speech. This is in June of 82, when the Falkland Islands War was just completed. And so here you have this 2.5-month, 3-month war on the surface, which was really about absconding with some black goo to take it over to the UK to weaponize it for the Anglo-American Empire. And you can bet that that's what's behind Thatcher and Reagan's conversations, both at the UN and in Vienna. That was sort of part of the constellation of diplomatic meetings around that. And I can remember going into the press conference that Margaret Thatcher held at the UN in New York in June of 82. I was maybe about 10 feet away from her in one of the front rows. And you know, my instinct said, you know, there's something more going on here than just a war. I mean, this is really, because there was a tremendous amount of power going down there in June of 82 at the UN. And fast forward to September 21st, 1987, Ronald Reagan is giving a speech at the UN. You know, you can Google it and you can listen to the whole speech now on video. It's right there. And he talks about, quote, the alien threat from outside this world. Well, what alien threat from outside this world is going on in the late to mid to late 80s? It's the black goo plasma nano oil, the off-planet invading sentient parasitical artificial intelligence that was known in June of 82 to both of these heads of state, or, you know, heads of government and head of state. And that was known to Reagan, and so we're putting forth the hypothesis that Thatcher and Reagan's, and especially Reagan's statements, was really about black goo, about the invading artificial intelligence. This is a hypothesis. Now, you can go to the exopolitical textbooks and articles, and they'll say, no. You know, you go to the Reagan library, and they say, well, that was just a speechwriter, and he just put something in there, and Ronnie was just, you know, really kind of wild. He was like a cowboy because he had a UFO experience once, and that's why they put that in the speech, you know? Well, you know, that's all cover story stuff. And so I think that we're really starting to get down into the stuff in it. And I feel that I was a journalist there 40 years ago, and that's what I was covering, was black goo. So I made my statement.
Okay, well, thank you. And here's just a slide that has quotes from Reagan.
Yeah, let me read it. This is the speech, yeah. And I can remember being in listening to his speech in the General Assembly Hall on September 21st, 1987. He says, "In our obsession with antagonisms of the moment, we often forget how much unites all the members of humanity. Perhaps we need some outside universal threat to make us realize this common bond. I occasionally think how quickly our differences would vanish if we were facing an alien threat from outside this world." I think that Reagan was talking about AI, and that was in his speech, and he repeats that throughout his tenure in office. He repeats it when he goes on to talk about his speech with Mikhail Gorbachev, and I was invited to the Soviet Union by Gorbachev because we produced the first radio program in history between the United States and the Soviet Union, the Institute of Cooperation, in 1987. So at this time, I was, you know, fairly visible in international broadcasting. So all of these puzzle pieces fit, at least for me. That's my subjective report to everybody right now.
Well, thank you. And just again, you know, I know that, you know, most likely that people that will listen to this are fairly well educated, but we've known for a long time that our government officials will always be making public statements that will be informing the public. And there seems to be some sort of code or honor or necessity that they do that. So it behooves us to read these words and using our own individual discernment, feel what it is that we feel that they were really saying. And so in keeping with what we're doing, that makes perfect sense to me, Alfred, that that's what he was telegraphing or informing us of.
Yeah, and for me, part of the emotion of this moment for me is after all these years, having an aha experience and saying, oh, that's what we were talking about. Mm-hmm. Rather than cruise missiles in Europe and all that kind of stuff, which was mm-hmm. current little war stuff, not the big war stuff.
Well, and now there's so much noise on the political front. It's so much babble, so much, you know, really nonsense. It's very difficult sometimes to actually get to the meat of what they're really saying. So, I mean, even in the days of Reagan and Eisenhower, I know, and Kennedy, if you go back to those speeches, there's a much more coherency in what they're actually telling us.
Yeah.
And it's not so easy anymore. And so we'll move through all of this. And just going now, we're looking at another situation that David Griffin also did talk about in his basis interview of the Deep Horizon BP oil spill disaster. And, you know, I'm just going to give a little subjective of my own reality at that moment when that happened. Because I rely a lot on intuitive deep earth feelings of what is being resonated in the field. When that happened, that for me on a level with a lot of people that I was working with at the time, it became a very big concern. And it wasn't even the science behind it or anything, but we knew that something else was being brought up from the deep. And it felt like
an alien, predatory entity. And that's how it felt to me all along. I think a lot of people would concur with that. And so I just do a little bit of the history here. There seems to have been a big worldwide standoff in the Gulf at that time that most people aren't aware of.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. That, again, I covered this in mainstream journalism and was invited onto Governor Jesse Ventura's program. We did some special programs on the Gulf. And this is an event that was prophesized by Argentine prophets. It was a big deal, and from the science point of view. And at that time, when I covered it in 2010, I didn't have a clue that it was about black goo. So right. If I didn't have a clue, that's why most of the world media did not have a clue.
Right. And, you know, because again, each of these topics could be a whole series on it. But we, you know, looking at how it was handled, how they used, what was the name of the chemical that they sprayed? Instead of using the safer, more ecologically...
Corexit.
Okay. And so instead of using the more ecological and already proven methods for cleaning up oil spill, they sunk it to the bottom. So it seems that there was a definite cover-up going on there. And so, you know, we have that. And it's, again, inviting people to really just Google this stuff, find the right research on it. It is out there. It is there for everybody to see. There's a beautiful, David Griffith does a great job of it. And I think that's a good place for people to start in his coverage of this. So Alfred, also just to kind of tie this slide back into it, you know, we know that when this black goo substance, it was actually used in these, in communication networks. It's immediately they started to use it as a program medium. And we'll talk a little bit in a moment about the Marconi strange deaths, or maybe we've already just kind of skipped over that. So this is a more modern, this is a more recent, let's say, rollout. And maybe you could tell us a little about this.
Sure. And this involves modern users of the internet and really the modern world citizen to really reframe everything that they know. And I know that there's a great deal of skepticism, but just go to our to news. We have a 12-part series on this with all the documentation. In the bottom center is Seven. She is a concept innovator from the UK who has won one of the largest intellectual property infringement awards in the history in the UK high courts. And that was based on the theft of her intellectual property by what I would call an AI-entrained criminal syndicate. This is where AI comes in, and they really take over individuals in law, in international television companies like BBC, ITV, Virgin Television, ABC TV. She brought forward the whole, she was a concept innovator of the whole Dancing with the Stars, all of the, you know, bringing fitness and dancing into mainstream TV. That is fitness shows, dancing, ABC's Dancing with the Stars. She went to one of London's leading corporate law firms, and what they did is that they stole her concept and then sold it to a consortium of television networks in 146 countries, including ABC's Dancing with the Stars. And you'll see many other spin-offs that are bringing in billions of dollars of revenue. And then this is the kind of perverse AI. They they have made her a targeted individual, such that she's a prisoner under remote targeting in her own apartment, with all sorts of vans, white vans saying 7 all and out of there. And the London bombing, 777, which was like London's 9/11, was a play on her name, 7, on 777, which was financed by the syndicate through the billions that they've made through ripping off her name. And it even comes down to Charlie Hebdo in January of 2015, which means Charlie 7. Her name is Charles 7. And that was done by the Rockefellers, who bought the building that Charlie Hebdo existed just a few months prior to the false flag, so they could do the Charlie Hebdo. So this is where they take an individual soul, they steal all of its creativity, because the AI doesn't have creativity. They have these enormous global conglomerates. They feed it through plasma HDTV to the worldwide publics and Dancing with the Stars, and they don't know that they're getting this ripped off stuff, which is really covert AI programming. And then they're using the proceeds to finance 777 and the Charlie Hebdo bombing, which in turn keeps all of the war, disease, crime, and poverty economy going, centered around the Rothschilds and the State of Israel, which ties up to Saturn. I know these are themes that we'll be touching on, but I just wanted to summarize it. That's the real individual 7 right there. Up in the upper left, that is Raynetta Jones, who is the actual inventor of the Apple iPod and the Amazon Kindle. The Apple iPod was converted into the Apple iPhone, became one of the main platforms and concept innovations that made the Apple iPhone that Steve Jobs did. And he admitted, he said, "We're great thieves, you know? See, they're just outright thieves." And so both these two individuals, Steve Jobs and Steve Jobs of Apple, who's now being lionized in a movie, and Jeff Bezos of Amazon, who's even taken over the Washington Post in conjunction with the CIA, are the modern day robber barons who are AI entrained. And now they have taken the invention. They're both Caribbean origin women. I'm from the Caribbean. I'm from Cuba. And, you know, part of my DNA is Cuban Indian. And so this is what AI does, is that they target the very soulful inventions of creative souls like 7 and Raynetta Jones, and they parlay them into these worldwide inventions, meanwhile targeting them. Right now, Raynetta Jones is living in a shelter for targeted women outside of the U.S. She was working at the UN, and they targeted her so much she had to flee the United States. This is extraordinary, and we've been able to keep Charles 7 alive by doing a 12-program series on both 7 and on Raynetta, and they are the ones who are keeping ABC and BBC alive and keeping Apple and Kindle alive, and Kindle through the Amazon, and Amazon through Kindle has now taken over the ebook, where they're destroying the book company and all of the book industry. I'm doing this so that people get a concept of what artificial intelligence is doing in our world. Now, this is what Sergeant Dan McBullen III of the U.S. Army says. "Alfred, the theft of the intellectual property of the Kindle and iPod was done because they needed a method for the viruses so that they could embed their own type of virus, namely bio-APIs of the invading sentient inorganic intelligence, black or gray goo. And so this is a United States military personnel who specialize in studying the invading artificial intelligence, affirming that that is what has happened in the case of Renetta Jones and in the case of Seven. And I just bring it to the public here that open your eyes and understand what Apple is all about and what Amazon and the Kindle and the theft of the Kindle are all about and what all these international law firms. I used to be with the largest international law firm in the world myself. That's how I started in law on Wall Street. So I know the ins and outs of these corridors. They have interlinked themselves with the television programs, with the plasma screens that we're all looking at right now, and with the internet itself. We'll get into all of these are artifacts of the invading artificial intelligence to take over humanity, and we better wake up. Thank you.
Thank you, Al. I have two questions. One question and one comment, and then if anybody else would like to. What is an bio API, first of all?
That's a term that Sergeant McBowen uses. In other words, it's a biologically based artificial intelligence.
Okay. So what I'm to understand is that biological artificial intelligence, it needed the interface of the iPod and the Kindle through these plasma-based screens so that it could... Basically, we're talking about subliminal or frequency embed into the human consciousness what it wants us to pick up.
Yes. That
it has no morals. It has no ethics. It has a sole objective, and it'll walk over and use anybody to get to where it wants to be.
Sole objective.
S-O-L-E. Right? But yes, I mean, so it has an agenda and a well... computed agenda.
Yeah.
Okay? It knows what it needs and it'll go get it when it needs it.
Yeah, and it's psychopathic because the same time, rather than honoring Seven, honoring Raynetta, it has put them in the most exploitative positions possible and debased them as much as possible as human beings.
So thank you. And to bring that these are two beautiful women that were used that way, but there's thousands and thousands and thousands of creative beings on the planet being used similarly right now too. And so I think that they're standing for us. And I want to make one other comment because I know that Steve Jobs is a controversial personage in our worldview. And it is within the potential to understand that he may have been taken over and used. And there is some speculation that at the end of his life, he was fighting off this AI, and that's why he ended up with cancer and he was taken out. And I just want to say that to make it, you know, like a lot of these people through either ego weaknesses or their own sense of greed or their own sense of power get utilized. A lot of times not even knowing that they themselves are being utilized. So that's just the only statement I wanted to make about that. Attention.
Yeah, and I'd like to say that in June of 1982, I personally drove out to the house of Steve Wozniak, co-founder of Apple, and picked up a check for $5,000 by which he financed our Peacequake, which was a peace concert in San Francisco Civic Center Plaza in support of the second special session of disarmament. So back then, Steve Wozniak was as human as all of us and involved in trying to get this into being a peaceful planet. And and that is the pernicious part of AI entrainment. And that's all of the complexities.
So right.
But I'm trying to bring out at the same time, you know, Jacques, because Apple knows what it's doing to Raynetta Jones.
Now it does.
And through this law judgment, BBC, and the woman lawyer who stole this has been made, Helen Alexander has been made a dame, and she sits in the House of Lords because of doing this.
Mm-hmm.
So we at the same time we cannot afford to throw out legal accountability here.
Not the point. It's just that so much of this, and we'll talk more, is how the human consciousness also has been compartmentalized, so that it, you can see how easily the good intent of a person, maybe in the beginning, their own genius, got taken over too, right? And at a certain level, at what point does the soul love resonance get taken over? And we'll talk about that a little bit more. And yeah, there should be accountability. Yes, there is accountability. Not should be, there is. So just, you know, to recap this section on the applications for the black goo and the sentient nano oil, the Marconi Electronics in the UK, also research that firm. It's a very interesting, even a Wikipedia search of that will give you a big clue as to who they are. So they use, what it says here, they switched on the sentient oil. It seems that the 25 strange deaths that they had, a lot of computing engineers and engineers at the time succumbed to some very, very extremely bizarre deaths that were never explained. And so the speculation runs that either they were taken out by the powers that didn't want what they knew to be given to the world, or simply they came in contact with this black goo and it created a very strange destructive psychosis in them. A lot of them seem to have taken their lives in very odd ways. We also know that the sentient oil appears to transmit radio frequency signals that are being used to construct a self-aware programmable sentinel grid around the Earth. Now, this is viewable to those that can see energy running, and we'll also get deeper into that in the rest of this. So we're constructing or reconstructing, and this is probably has to do a little bit with the Draco leaving the planet and leaving this intact, so that the sentinel grid is actually being run here on the planet at this moment. Other applications were weather satellites. Maybe you want to talk about that, Alfred, a little bit. Communication networks, including electric wires. A sensitive person that works in the unseen world can read these signals, can actually even see sometimes the astral projections coming out of these signals, off the wires, off our Wi-Fi devices, and certainly through our plasma screens. So that's another thing. Another part of this is the use of nano or smart dust, which we'll talk about a little bit more in depth later, which is being used to embed in roads, buildings, and other inorganic structures, which is literally turning our world into a world that can be mapped everywhere we step and everywhere we think. So I'm not sure if we want to have more to say on this because we're going to touch on these things, but if somebody wants to say something, please do.
No, I think you've covered it there.
Okay, all righty. Just trying to recap. Okay, so this is the part of this where you're going to see kind of a little bit of a horrific imagery. We're talking about also now, we've got this sentient black oil, all right? We know that we can document this now. So terraforming the Earth into a dystopia or transhumanism. So we're talking about a society that is undesirable or frightening. And so terraforming the Earth into dystopia, one version is that the black goo was left as a doomsday weapon by rogue groups of ETs, so that if they were ever ejected from the Earth, they could trigger it remotely to terraform the Earth into dystopia. Another version is, and we'll talk about both of these, meteors or asteroids carrying a pathogenic spider insect species entered the Earth's solar system. So, Jeffrey, you might want to also join us a little bit because I know you've looked at a lot of this yourself and done a lot of
Yeah, I actually have something.
Yeah, go ahead.
Say, I'm trying to find the slide on my own.
Okay.
Perspective of pattern recognition between the microscopic systems in the cell, and then we're talking about macroscopic systems, and we look for where the patterns overlap, basically. So what's interesting is that we've already talked about how a virus infects a cell and how the descriptional similarities it shares with the sequence, how the sequence of events are laid out, how black goo came. I mean, that when I was talking about Michael Harner's experience that he had with the shamans. And there's also, even in, if we look in certain mythologies and spiritual creation mythos, such as the Gnostics, for instance, mm-hmm. and they describe the fall of mankind and and what happened. There are viral elements to the story in terms of how it's described, and in some instances, you can even replace some of the terms with cell and virus, and you would be thinking that you were reading a journal entry in some cell biology research journal. But what I wanted to say pertaining to this slide is that I think it might have been the slide before that, as far as terraforming. Mm-hmm. If we consider the Earth as a cell, a virus actually terraforms a cell. If we're looking just from a microscopic perspective, there's the vegetative phase of the virus is when the viral particles are assembling and creating new virions, which are basically like spores. And there is a theory of viruses by a man named Bandeja, and it's called Bandeja's hypothesis. And it's that, I'm reading this here, according to Bandeja's hypothesis, the infected cell is the virus, while the virus particles are spores or reproductive forms. His theory was largely ignored until the discovery of the Mimi virus, which replicates the DNA genome and produces new virions in the cytoplasm with complex viral factories. So the vegetative phase of the virus basically terraforms the cell, changes the cellular machinery, and uses some of the cellular material to create new viral factories, like little organelles that are that replicate the virus. So it hijacks the creative machinery of the cell on the one hand, but it actually creates its own kind of atmosphere and workspace, basically, using parts of the cell, so the idea is that on a large scale system, if we look at the Earth as a cell, we can kind of see it already being terraformed by the viral intelligence that we're dealing with now. And the viral factories that it has set up are things like DARPA, for instance. That's just one example. I mean, we could consider, if we're talking, I mean, this is creative conceptualization here. So this isn't about right or wrong. It's just a matter of pattern recognition and discussing the implications. So the idea is that things like DARPA or any kind of company or organization that's dedicated to mass producing consumer electronics, or that is connected with the development of maybe the infrastructure of the internet, for instance, software development, pushing toward bringing strong AI into manifestation into our physical world. These kind of organizations collectively kind of form the viral factories, and this is where the replication and bringing in of viral material, genetic material, which is equated with the viral genetic material in the cell, is equated with the viral consciousness on the large scale that we're talking about with here. So the organizational bodies that are related to these microscopic equivalents of viral factories are bringing in to existence this viral intelligence and building bodies for it as a cell builds new bodies for the virus, genetic material of the virus. So and according to this idea, the terraforming of the Earth is already well underway. I mean, yeah. if we look at even things like urban sprawl on the planet, looks like necrotic tissue death. Yes, but if we're talking about being places for viral replication of viral intelligences, on a psychic level, as far as thought forms go, and on a physical level, as far as the development of machines and developing AI, it's really interesting that urban sprawl looks like it does, because we'll get into this a little later too. Is that one of the viral factories, or the one of the things that a virus does can do when it infects a cell, is build what's called a membranous web. So it uses some of the material from the endoplasmic reticulum of the cell to build a web of its own, where it broods basically and reproduces. Mm-hmm. So that's a big part of, I think we're going to start getting into a little later in this presentation, but that's what I'd have to say as far as terraforming goes, that it happens in a cell.
Right. So when we're looking at that, because we're going to be talking a little bit also about this invasion, let's say this invasive species is actually a sort of type of mind virus, mm-hmm. where it affects the neural pathways and the way we think, the way we view our world. And the reason that the part of this, the transhumanist agenda or the rise of the technocrat is the, and I'll get into that in this, what is technocracy, right? What is a belief system or a, what is driving it? What is driving the human being that is doing the, that is working in these viral factories? Mm-hmm. What is it that's keeping them in that space, right? Because mm-hmm. they lost touch with an aspect of themselves. They are compartmentalized. They're not in touch with the larger humanity. And so we have something behind that, and that is technocracy, which is the idea, and it is a type of, I'll just read from it, all right? A theory and a movement that was prominent in 1932, about 1932, advocating control of industrial resources, reform of financial institutions, and reorganization of the social system based on the finding of technologists and engineers. Now that's straight from Wikipedia. So we can actually sit here and look at our world right now, and we can say that it really is technocracy that is driving it, because these are the things that there is a control. There's a control element here. So if technocracy is also the basis of all collectivism under such a system, elites are to decide based on a combination of science, metaphysics, and personal whim, just how society is to be designed and controlled. The essential nature of such a collectivist system is regimentation of all members of society under the tutelage of the elite, and that's from Dr. Russell Blaylock. So I'm brought this into this aspect of it because what's driving this? What is the, you know, what is the mind process here that is going through the engineer, the person that is isolated from their more organic source, certainly not working out of a love. We have our controlling elite right there. And so technocracy, we have control, we keep you safe, and we are your hope. How many political messages are based on that? It's so simple when you look at it.
And a large part of it comes down to distraction. You know, mm-hmm. Whether it be with presidential elections or, mm-hmm. you know, the latest series of True Blood or some HBO special or what's happening with the Kardashians or, and it, you know, right. things like this. And they have it so whatever tickles your fancy, basically, you can keep yourself occupied with that instead of going inward and examining your own mind and psychic processes. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting because, again, I'm going to bring it back to the cell, is that the virus, when it infects the cell, hijacks its creative machinery. And when we say creative machinery, we're talking specifically about the ribosomes in the cell. The ribosomes in the cell translate viral proteins to make new bodies for the virus. Okay, and there's also an enzyme that is similar to a ribosome that translates the genetic material of the virus. So the virus gets its genetic material replicated and it gets new bodies built for it in the cell. And the ribosomes and this other enzyme, it's some kind of polymerase, but it's part of the host cell's machinery, creative machinery. The virus has used this in order to replicate itself, and it depends on this machinery because the virus lacks this machinery. Mm-hmm. So if the idea is that we have a ribosomal faculty of mind, that there's a connection between our physiology on a biological level and our psychic makeup. So our psychic being, our inner reality is structured, the cell is structured after that, kind of an as above, so below deal. So the idea is that we have a psychic faculty of mind, which we use to take to translate ideations or intuitions or whatever into thought forms or proteins. We bring them into manifestation, whether we turn it into language or art or music or architecture or anything like this. This is bringing something into manifestation, like a ribosome brings a protein into manifestation. So what the cell does when it's infected is it sends signals to the ribosomes to stop translating, to halt protein production, right? Because it doesn't want the cell to translate viral proteins. So the idea is that we're being kept distracted from looking inward at our ribosomal faculty of mind and observing our mind and observing our thoughts, trying to distinguish what's coming from within and what's coming from without, right? Because we're constantly being fed viral material and just replicating it without second thought, just like it happens in a cell, you know. And there are, and we can talk about this later on, but there are we can map the mechanisms of the cell stress response, the immune response of the cell, to halt protein production, to the establishment of certain mental and emotional spiritual disciplines that were introduced on the planet, you know. Mm-hmm. Namely ones that have you meditate to watch your thoughts, or to halt, to try and right. stop the cessation of thoughts. This is just like the cell signals the ribosomes to halt protein production. There's a deep connection here, but we'll probably get into that a little mm-hmm. bit later. I'll pass yeah. it back to you though.
Well, thank you for that. And so just to make a little synopsis of the basis of what you're saying is that there's a biological process within the human that is actually creating the reality. We are actually, and when we're hosted or parasited by these AI type entrainments and things, then we're creating for them, basically.
Right. But they also, and we'll get into this later, is that everything has... a purpose, you know,
right.
And there's competitive pockets of perception right. where we're looking at a certain scope and you see the competition, but then you look, you broaden the perspective and you see that it's all part of one living mm-hmm. organism. It's part mm-hmm. of a larger ecosystem.
Right.
I mean, it's the same in a forest or a jungle. You look and you see, competition of resources and, you know, predator prey relationships, parasite prey relationships. But then when you consider the forest as one large superorganism in which all the, you know, animals and plants function as different organs of a larger body, you see the cooperation and the harmony of the larger perspective, mm-hmm. you know. But again, I'm not insisting that this is natural, so we should just allow it to happen. But there's an element of discernment that I think is lacking that needs to be brought into the right. picture. And biology can teach us a lot about mm-hmm. that element.
Okay. Well, and I know later on in the presentation we'll go deeper into that that interface that we have with all of life, and you know, that is part of you know, the biggest problems that we do have is that we've lost that interconnectedness with each other in life and everything that's coming around.
And there's a reason for that too. And again, this can be mapped to what happens when a virus infects a cell,
okay.
as far as interfering with the evolution of basically the human body and how the soul interfaces with the body and with the environment. Anyway,
okay.
We can talk about that later, but I...
right, I know. I mean,
yeah, it's
right.
It's great.
I'll let you know. Right here is because I just pulled a quote from, it's been quoted many times by Arthur C. Clarke. Any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. So we're going to tie back in a little bit with technology, which is magic, which goes into the shamanistic view that you gave earlier, right? So perceptual, you know, technology can look like magic. Is this the black magician's latest rollout on keeping humanity locked into serving its needs?
Mm-hmm.
Or look at that. So I'm just going to go through this unless somebody wants to say anything. I'm going to stop for a minute. I don't know, Alfred or Claudia, did you want to say anything?
Just that I found Jeffrey's whole discourse on the cell and on the invasion of a cell by a virus and the analogy to the invasion of the human community individually and larger as a community, whichever you know, either as a species or on down to the individual. Okay. I found that extremely enlightening and kind of a template by which we can begin to view and plan responses as a human species and as communities to this invading, predatory force, or, you know, invading predator. And that's all I just want to say, as the Greek chorus, I want to say, yeah, wow, that's really important.
You know, Alfred, I feel like we just connected. I can feel I can feel a big smile in the center of my chest.
So, oh, great.
Yeah.
It's beautiful. Yeah, and I don't know what's going on with my PowerPoint. It's not
going oh, so AI is making itself known and saying, hey guys, I just want you to know that I'm here. Is that it?
All right, okay. Yeah.
What's going on here?
No, I'm sorry.
I think that if you go back one, we'll be where we're supposed to be. There.
Right. I was going to say, if anybody wanted, Claudia, you were going to talk. Okay, I'm keeping my hands off the machine for the moment.
I think I'm forming a theory here. What Jeffrey was saying about the virus, Jeffrey, could that be kind of likened to what is commonly considered a measles virus, for example, in that when a child develops measles, she or he gets first very grumpy, and this is the stage the illness actually is happening, and then the virus moves in order to clean up the system. And then the child recovers, and it makes perhaps a developmental jump, which is very often recorded. Like, for example, many children who struggle with reading, learning to read, they come down with measles, and then suddenly they can read without any effort. Or if their motoric skills are not brilliant at first, and then they come down with one of those childhood diseases, and suddenly, you know, their motoric skills are brilliant. So what if this, what we call predatory force, is used or acts in exactly that same manner in order to wake humanity up to their full potential?
Yeah, there's after any sickness, there's a resiliency to the body after it bounces back. You know, after you've been kind of down for a while and then all of a sudden you start feeling good again, it's like bliss, you know. And the immune system always learns something from whenever it's infected, you know, so there's definitely an element to that. And viruses in life, and yeah, they're considered genetic parasites, and they have sneaky, underhanded, you know, methods to enter into a cell. But half of the human genome is actually viral in origin, you know, so there's, we can't separate life, you know, you can't. Everything is, I mean, self-contained. There's a purpose to everything. And there's an essential part of our nature that which I think we're going to talk about later with the chromosomes image, that there's an element of us in what's coming, you know, or what's here. And there's an element of us in that, you know, and there's something to be taken away from all this that's going to benefit us greatly down the road of the rest of our journey, you know, here and elsewhere. So, but right now, and again, I'm not saying that in terms of we should just lie down and you know, let it happen, because part of that.
No, heck no.
Yeah, part of the learning is in the struggle. So, right. You know, what we have, the potential knowledge that we have to walk away, that the potential knowledge that we can walk away with coming out of this thing is going to be not only helpful to us, but also helpful to others mm-hmm. down the road, you know, others that we yeah. encounter. And I'm talking about a spiritual journey that, you know, lies beyond yeah. the cocoon of the earth that we're, you know, developing in right now. So there's, and these are all, this is, but yes, what you're saying, I think, is dead on. And some of what you said, kind of sounded like, you know, pleomorphism, as far as they come in because they have basically something to do there. There's a food source for them. Mm-hmm. And then they make this kind of, transition. I think you used, there was a jump. I think you used it in a different, context, though, as far as somebody walking away with a new knowledge. But anyway, yes, I agree with that observation.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Jeffrey. Thank you, Claudia. It's been something that there is a slide up ahead about that too. Is that, you know, what is the immune response? And one of the ways that we've all looked at it in our journeying here and exploring together is that we are part of an immune response. The human that goes through these trials that comes in perhaps to help raise or heal will ultimately be leaving the templates or the new immune responses, not just for themselves, but for the planet.
This is, the black goo is all about DNA wars. You know, and which we've talked about, and that one theory is that rogue ET groups, like the Draga reptilians, the Orion Greys, the Anunnakis, the Andromedans, and others, is all this is like, you know, it's an exopolitic soup. So this is assignments for the exopolitical community. Introduced the sentient AI as a weapon that could be remotely triggered. And you keep on getting that through the disparate researchers and through the whistleblowers from the inside, the Argentinians who were talking to the blue ETs, because as we'll see in the Save Our Solutions, one of the solutions is as a human community, when you want to get back in touch with the blue ETs, get this Anglo-American empire out of the way, who've been working with the Dracos, get back in the blue ETs to get back on the job that they were doing since World War I and re-engineering this stuff. You know, so that people have an idea of where we're going. So that these rogue ET groups may have introduced it as kind of a dead man's trigger, you know, well, you want to get us, we'll get you. Or that collectively, some people say, no, what happened is that all of these groups, as part of an historical exopolitical process that has a lot of different names, some of which are even talked about in the Old and New Testament, which refer to historical events, that they actually morphed and devolved into a collective intelligence that became soulless and synthetic. So we're looking at an echo from a past galactic war, mm-hmm. where all these guys went, they you know, Star Wars, we're looking at the Empire. If you want to use that analogy, so we're kind of talking in signs and symbols here, mm-hmm. You know, just to help people. Hal Casavella, the scientist, talks a lot about the spider species, and you'll find as we go through these slides, there's a lot coming up there because the whole spider and the web. I'm a Weber. Gee, I wonder why I chose that last name when I came into this incarnation. Maybe it had to do with Webers and spiders and the World Wide Weber. Well, and being, you know, just my soul being like aware of that whole aspect of it, you'll find that all of a sudden spiders start appearing in all sorts of contexts of the internet and of revelations, and oh, there's this huge spider. Oh, is that the internet? Oh, and is you'll find a lot of connections that Jeffrey is really becoming an expert on at explaining. And so I look forward to that part of this section. You can say that the collective memory of this spider-like species is approaching life-bearing planets seeking to morph into and take over the conscious core of humans and of the living being, Gaia. There are all sorts of names for the being that has incarnated as in the third dimension, the universes of time, space, energy, and matter, where we incarnate as Christine and Jeffrey and Claudia and Alfred and all of those watching here. That being incarnates as the planet Earth, and that being has various names like Gaia and Sophia, and you know, these are all sciences. This is the science of the omniverse that is just beginning to come into human consciousness and emerge. And Shane, who could not make it today because AI rescheduled him, I guess AI is rescheduling him for another session of our series for our part four on focusing on his deep insider knowledge of AI coming out through the Illuminati end of things. Artificial intelligence technologies have been transferred to the Earth Matrix controllers to operate the secret space program. Mm-hmm. And they operate, our intelligence agencies. They operate military mass surveillance, other systems. They're known as the Red Queen. They're known as Victoria. Jade Helm 15 is the first taste that the American public got in June and July of 2015 up to September, kind of as a preview then when the Jesuit Pope came in and kicked AI up to the UN level, that the United States is really run by an AI. That is, the United States strategic functions are run by an AI. And in interpreting world events, you can say that the rapid collapse after the September 2015 speech of Vladimir Putin and that sector, that exopolitical sector intervention to destroy the AI-operated ISIS units in Syria, and the collapse of that AI initiative and planetary takeover, you can follow world events because by showing that the Draco reptilian forces who have maintained the Western alliances, the U.S., Israel, UK interventions that are mainly suppressing their populations and promoting the internet and all of that. Well, some people say that Vladimir Putin was on the moon and coordinated all this stuff when he disappeared for 10 days and then came back. And now we have the collapse of one very negative part of the AI entrained humans, which is the society that we four kind of live in, which is the orbit of the Rothschild bloodline banker controlled AI controlled event. So I'm just doing all of this so that people can begin to look at, you know, since my focus is as a lawyer, international lawyer, judge, journalist, public events, all of that kind of thing. You can look through those flimsies, as well as the scientists that Jeffrey looks at, and each of us has our own perspectives. There's a way to look at public events and sit back and say, okay, which part of the Star Wars is winning now, and what's really going on, and who do I want to back, and who do I want to withdraw
my sovereign consent from. Mm-hmm. And finally, the stealth nature. You know, why is it that, gee, we're just talking about this now? I mean, I got into exopolitics in 73, and I was on the scene in 82, and I wasn't talking about any of this until 2015. What is the stealth nature of artificial intelligence, and why is it that we're working so hard to bring it to the public now? Mm-hmm. And that one principal evidentiary finding is that the extreme stealth nature of sentient inorganic artificial intelligence deployment on Earth and its use of imitation and artifice in creating artificial versions of dimensions such as time. There's actually an artificial timeline that the AI has created that everybody from politicians, politics, all of politics and all of religion and all of Hollywood is up there on the artificial timeline. And if you spend your time up there, you're in la-la land because you've been what we call AI entrained. Mm-hmm. So that's what this slide really talks about. It's kind of like a summary. And we're trying also to bring an AI awareness, how to create that double, triple, quadruple, multidimensional vision so that you understand as a soul-based human what you're incarnating to and what reality you're projecting yourself into. And what the different stakeholders and competitions are.
Wow. Wow. Two thoughts, if I may.
Yeah.
On point number one, and this has come up before in other conversations I've had, when we look at the DNA war hypotheses, we can also look at human beings, okay, human beings in this human body vessel. Many say that we're, you know, being farmed. And so, and there's also the idea too that the Greys came back to pick up the DNA because they messed with it so much in the past, they need it for the future. They know what's going to happen. Or they come back from the future to reharvest or realign the DNA in the human so that the events don't turn out the same way they did before. So I'm just getting the feeling though, when you were saying that, Alfred, is like, you know, what better way? I mean, all geneticists do this, all, you know, how they do this with plant life, but put it under stress. You stress out the gene pool to an extreme and you get an expression from it as a response. So I kind of got the feeling when you were saying that, like, you know, the war is for the human DNA. This is why all of these species have come here, is to be able to harvest it to some degree. And the second nature, just want to add, when we say AI and trained, I will just add, hook onto there, the predatory black magician that is on the planet that is using AI for its means. And I think they're pretty much indistinguishable at this point. There has to be a consciousness host for something of that nature. That's just the points that came to my mind when you were saying that. So, yeah, so looking at, you know, a supposedly maybe one-time human being that got so taken over that they now become a black magician at service to this AI agenda. Or was it the other way around?
Very good. I'm a kid, 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 I'm a kid
day.